hard debate, this intense debate taking place between pro-slavery and anti-slavery, right? And many anti, you know, many abolitionists are obviously white, as Kevin has pointed out. And one of these abolitionists' name is John Brown. Now, John Brown, I want to emphasize again, is all over our history books. If you studied the Civil War in school, in high school even, you would have run into the name John Brown. So I want to emphasize that just to show that everything you read in secular history, behind the scenes, there are some fascinating, there's a strong presence of the Adventist community. So John Brown decides, and I'm just gonna butcher the history a bit, and you guys just jump in and let's flesh this out. John Brown decides that slavery must end, and it can end friendly, patting each other on the back or asking nicely. It has to end with some force, right? So he gathers a little group together and they decide that they're going to inspire slave rebellion, right? In order to overturn the slave masters. So he conducts a raid on a federal arsenal, Harper's Ferry, all right? And it's the year's 1859. This event is considered by many historians as one of the major catalysts for sealing the Civil War. The Civil War is happening. He was captured. They were not successful. He was hanged. And the slaves that he gathered were all killed. Right. This explodes throughout the news, throughout the nation. And Adventists were picking up the newspapers and they were reading as well. I leave it to you there. How did the Adventists respond? Were there any connections? Were there any secondary, tertiary connections to this event? And how were the early Adventist leaders responding to this?
Well, let me throw in one thing. And I think Ben and Kevin are both going to have much more powerful things to say on this, but you know what happened with Brown is what he did was strategically made no sense. Frederick Douglass said, "I'm not going to go along with that. It's crazy." But when Brown was put on trial, most of the moderate, respectable Northern press denounced him. But when he was put on trial and he was given an opportunity to speak, he was so powerful and so eloquent in nailing the political, the injustices that had accumulated in the nation and giving this diagnosis that it's almost seems that's what was supposed to happen. I just leave it at that.
Beautiful.
Let me back up too before the raid. So an important factor that made his raid possible, even though it was unsuccessful, was a group of six men that historians have called the Secret Six. And these are men who knew about John Brown's raid, and at least some of the details, the exact amount of details is difficult to determine by historians, but they at least knew about the general outlines. And one of these men was Gerrit Smith. And I mentioned him a little earlier. Gerrit Smith had been a Millerite. He went through the Great Disappointment. And in fact, on October 21, 1844, he writes a letter to his wife and says, "We've had worship probably for the last time." And so he actually believed that Christ was coming back on October 22, 1844.
Proper Millerite.
A short time after that, he adopts the Seventh-day Sabbath. And Seventh-day Adventists interacted with him quite a bit. So some other connections that are super important. One of his next-door neighbors and very close friends was James Caleb Jackson. And if you know anything about Adventist history, it's James Caleb Jackson who operated our home on the hillside in Dansville, New York. And James and Ellen White go there to learn about health reform. And they stayed there on two occasions. They knew him personally. Also, Gerrit Smith's daughter, Elizabeth, is the one who designs and the first woman to wear a dress called the American Costume. And it is that dress that Ellen White sees and says, that's great, but it's not exactly what God wants in mind. And so she creates her own reform dress in contrast to that very dress that Garrett Smith's daughter made. Mm-hmm. And I can also add, a Seventh-day Adventist minister, a black former slave, John West, lived 300 feet from his mansion in Peterborough, New York.
And was from Garrett Smith's mansion.
From Garrett Smith's mansion. And so he is preaching on Sabbaths there in Peterborough. And let me also go back. I mentioned Samuel W. Rhodes. He's the one who comes up with this two-horned beast argument. He's the one who creates the first chart. He knew Garrett Smith personally and had eaten at his table in his home. And so there are connections here. We don't know how deep and how far they go, but Seventh-day Adventists knew this man. Joseph Bates in 1850, I think it was, goes to Peterborough and preaches on the sanctuary doctrine and the Sabbath. Garrett Smith is in attendance.
Wow.
And even though Garrett Smith doesn't accept the quote-unquote sanctuary doctrine, he is a Seventh-day Sabbath keeper, and they have great conversations. And, of course, they commiserate, and they have a lot to share when it comes to abolition as well. And so there are strong connections here. And so Garrett Smith, he is one of the members of the Secret Six. And this is fraught with irony and in so many ways, because Garrett Smith eventually is supportive of violence to eradicate slavery. And so he finances not just John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry, but he had also financed before, a few years earlier, his activity in Kansas, which led to what's called Bleeding Kansas, where pro-slavery Southerners are fighting against Yankees and New Yorkers in Kansas, whether or not to decide whether or not Kansas will adopt a slavery constitution. And so Garrett Smith is eventually doing this, but get this, when he is funding John Brown, he is concurrently the vice president of the American Peace Society. He's a pacifist. He is continuing to uphold, to the best of his ability, a belief in pacifism, while also trying to reconcile to the, it's gut-wrenching to try to deal with this problem, this horrible issue of slavery, where people are being abused in every kind of way, in the South as well as in the North. And so he's torn. And so eventually, even as a vice president of the American Peace Society, he funds John Brown's raid. And then whenever the news comes out that he has been involved, he will be so fraught over this that he actually will deny it publicly. And he will destroy all of his personal correspondence and letters and diaries to try to show that he was involved. He destroys all of that. And the issue actually made him lose his sanity. And he ends up in the Utica Insane Asylum for a few months. And so this shows how deeply troubling it was to him. But John Brown, I don't know how many connections he has with Millerites, but his brother-in-law was also a Millerite. They had some issues back and forth. They didn't get along a whole lot, but I don't know that it had anything to do with Millerism. But nevertheless,
I was going to say, let's bring it home with the fascinating story of...
I want to turn it to Ben now. Ben, tell us about Ellen White's response to John Brown.
Tell us about that train ride, and then we need to land this plane on that train ride.
Yes, this was shortly after John Brown's raid, and the newspapers were full of reports of it. And Loughborough was traveling with Ellen White in 1859, and this is what Loughborough writes about the occasion. And of course, we know that Loughborough was, for all intents and purposes, the first Adventist historian. Although he was a lay Adventist historian, he wrote what we consider to be the first proper book of Adventist history, The Rise, help me out, guys.
The Rise and Progress of the Second Advent Movement.
Later became Great Second Advent Movement.
Right. Yes.
And so he says, as we read of John Brown's failure, we became somewhat mirthful over what seemed to us like a foolhardy enterprise. Had we known that we afterward learned why his scheme failed, we would have felt different. We learned that hundreds had promised to join him that day at Harper's Ferry, not for plunder, but with the one object of liberating the slaves. The people did not come like Gideon's 22,000, fearful and faint-hearted, they stand at home. And forgive this, the English is really bad because this is just Loughborough writing down his reminiscences. Sister White at once checked our smiles over Brown's case. She said, quote, Brown's motives in that movement were all right. His sympathies were aroused for the cruel treatment of the slaves. That led him to make the move he did to secure for them what our Declaration of Independence says all men are entitled to, liberty. Let me read that again. This is Ellen White. This is John Loughborough reporting what Ellen White says. She says, John Brown's sympathies were aroused to the cruel treatment of the slaves that led him to make the move he did to secure for them what our Declaration of Independence says all men are entitled to, liberty. Brown's raid was not for plunder nor murder. Then she gave us to understand that there would be a move on a greater scale than Brown's that would liberate the slaves. Surely that prediction has been fulfilled. And of course, we know that one of Ellen White's key early predictions, I wouldn't say early predictions, but she predicted the Civil War and the great loss, but even more than that prediction, the great loss that would occur with the Civil War, with some 700,000. Interestingly, and this bears on Kevin's research, interestingly, she said, was this at Roosevelt, New York, Kevin? Where she had the vision about the Civil War? Parkville, Michigan. She said that some here will lose their children, the men and their family, to the war. And Kevin has recently done research. Oh boy, here we go. That bears out that there were a plethora, almost I think 10% of the men who were of age of Adventists who fought on the side of the Union in the Civil War to free the enslaved blacks. And so this is an amazing bombshell. Before Kevin's research, we didn't know that Adventists were involved as much as they were in the Civil War. So, Jeffrey, this is activism, social justice activism, on an entirely different level. Greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life.
Beautiful. And to go back to the Brown episode, Ben, you've outlined beautifully there. I mean, there's this effort, right? This desperate effort to do something about this horrible situation, and the politicians are not doing it. And he takes matters into his own hands, and the situation becomes violent, and there's destruction of property and more violence. And these guys are on the train with Ellen White, and they're laughing. Oh man, this guy's crazy. Look, what is he doing? This is crazy. And Ellen White says, stop laughing. Stop making fun of him, because in essence, in my own words, she's saying, what's the big picture here? Look at the bigger picture. And somebody in the comments said, wait, is Ellen White condoning murder? Because John Brown and them were that's a beautiful question in the comments, because that's exactly, I think, the point we're making here. The point is, no, she did not condone murder. The point is, while not condoning murder, she was able to back up and to look at the bigger picture of what people in the heart of hearts were trying to do. So you can withhold your endorsement of the violence that took place at the John Brown raid at Harper's Ferry, while at the same time legitimize the heart of the cause and what people are crying out to do. And the obvious implications of that, right? I mean, we've been bombarded with news that our great cities. I mean, I was in LA for months, and now I'm in the San Francisco Bay Area, and craziness happening on the streets, and there's rioting, and there's violence, and the destruction of property, and it's very easy to just cling to that and to lose the bigger picture, to lose the bigger picture of what's happening in our society, rather than sitting back and piously criticizing. Ellen White said, stop criticizing John Brown's raid. Yes, craziness went on, and we don't need to endorse that. But you are missing the point if you're not getting the bigger picture of what's happening here. What he was trying to do was redress the violation of human dignity. And we need to jump on board with that. And I think that that's just very powerful.
Jeffrey, real quick, just one more word. When you look at slavery and what was happening in slavery, lives were already being lost. You get me?
Yes.
Lives were already being lost. So, I mean, today, not to draw too close a parallel for our, those listening, but people are already dying. Okay? People are already dying. So that's the thing with John Brown's raid. Mm. It's trying to overthrow a system that is already killing people. So when you ask the question, does Ellen White condone violence, or was she condoning John Brown's murder, which in effect, we now know, scholars now know that John Brown was in a military mindset. And so, you know, I mean, we could have a whole nother discussion about military ethics, okay? And as to if something's really murder, if you do it in context of war. But we won't go there. We will not go there with an Adventist audience, okay? But people were already dying in slavery.
Yeah, and when
you say, was she condoning murder? It's like he was trying to overthrow a system in which more people would die in a couple of days than, it's kind of a moral quagmire when you try to go there.
Anyway. And what we said earlier is really easy. Like, I'm sitting here, I'm in Palo Alto, California, man. This is like paradise, right? I'm in hearing the birds chirping. I'm seeing the little squirrels, literally right now, watching squirrels climbing trees. This is a beautiful, quintessential American dream neighborhood, right? It's very easy to sit on this couch right now, on this chair, and cast judgment on people who are living in an absolute crisis of a situation, crisis of existence, and not sympathize with the messiness of what it means to live in this world with corrupt powers and corrupt policies. And so anyways, we need to wrap up here. We're running out of time. As much as I